behalf of Nicole, Drew, and Garrett, and the rest of the Clayton family, I want to thank you for coming and joining us today. At this time, I'm going to have you pause, and we're going to bring the family forward, and they're going to sit. So we're going to go ahead and bring them in. And I just want you to reflect, and we'll gather ourselves up, and we'll get through this. A little bit of housekeeping while we're waiting for them. Afterwards, they'd like you to join them. The Clayton family will be out right here to your left under the pergola, and you guys can greet them and show your respects. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we join today celebrating Robert Clayton, the man that he was. And Lord, I just ask that you be with us in this time. Help us to have a time that we can look back fondly upon Robert. And Lord, I just pray that your peace would be felt among us. And Lord, I just ask that you would walk among us today. This is a tough day, but Lord, give us opportunity to rejoice in you. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. My name is Thad Rummage, and I'm an elder here at the Heights. I guess that's what officially makes me appropriate for doing this, but more importantly, I've known the Claytons for a number of years. The boys, our kids have played soccer together. Nicole works for me, and so I am deeply honored. This is the rag one of my sons picked out to bring to me. A red one, tore it with knots in it. That's my kids. Robert Clayton, Jr., 48 of Prescott, Arizona, passed away on January 10, 2022, surrounded by his wife and his two sisters. He was born to parents Robert D. Clayton, Sr. and Jerry Lynn Jones Clayton on October 29, 1973, in Tucson, Arizona. Robert graduated from Chaparral High School in Las Vegas, Nevada, where he excelled in baseball and received a scholarship to play for Mount San Jacinto Community College in Hemet, California. After returning to Las Vegas, he met and married Nicole Reed, the love of his life, on October 21, 2000, in Las Vegas, Nevada, where they welcomed their firstborn son, Drew, in 2005. Not long after, in March of 2007, Robert and Nicole moved to Prescott and welcomed their second child, son, Garrett, in 2010. Moving to Prescott was always his wife's wish, which was made aware of her on their first date, of course, and Robert made that happen. Robert was well known for his love for family, cooking, camping, exploring, off-roading, golf, and baseball. He was blessed with an extraordinarily large heart, an amazing sense of humor, as well as the ability to befriend those he encountered through his job and community. Robert also loved to collect firearms. In fact, he could fix any gun regardless of the difficulty. He also possessed the ability to fix anything endearing to him and to his children, nicknamed MacGyver. Until his passing, Robert held the position of branch manager and senior loan officer for Smart Mortgage. Additionally, in 2021, Robert received the United Wholesale Mortgage Fastest Growing Loan Officer Award. He will be sorely missed by those who worked along currently and previously with him, many friends, and most of his loving family. Robert is survived by his wife of 21 years, Nicole, sons Drew and Garrett, sisters Kristen and Laura, brothers-in-law Mike and Rob, nieces Carrie, Katie, Leah, and Sarah, nephews Matthew, Luke, and Will, numerous aunts, uncles, cousins, and second cousins. Nicole would like me to read a poem to you that she selected. He only takes the best. God saw he was getting tired and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around him and whispered, "Come with me." With fearful eyes, tearful eyes, we watched him suffer and saw him fade away. Although we love him dearly, we could not make him stay. A golden heart stopped beating, hardworking hands to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best. Although his heart stopped beating, his love always remains. His absence puts on our hearts a very heavy strain. For now he is in a place of everlasting rest. We just have to understand that God, he only takes the best. I'm going to start with some memories that Nicole asked me to read on her behalf and to discuss. One of the things, as Robert was passing in the hospital, the doctors came to her and they said all of his organs are failing. All except his heart. His heart was very strong, and everybody that knew Robert knew he had a big heart, beautiful heart, and he loved his family and friends so much. She also shares he always be with us, whether through a dream or whisper in your ear telling you, "You got this, buddy." How they met was a great story, because Robert did banking where Nicole did banking, or was a banker. And he would come in, and eventually one of the other bankers said, "You know, I think he's got a thing for you, Nicole." And she denied that. And she said, "Well, he does his banking here." And she goes, "Yeah. Have you looked at his transactions?" I said, "Well, not really." He said, "Well, every day he takes out $20. And on Friday, he deposits 80. She figured it out. I'm going to have Drew and Garrett come on up. You guys ready? Come on around, fellas. It's interesting to me, because every time I thought of memories and so forth with Robert, I couldn't help but to laugh and chuckle, because that's just the way it was with Robert. These fine young men. This is Garrett.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to talk a little bit about my dad and how he was such an amazing person. Every time we maybe got a little emotional or sad, he would always comfort us with this very nice talk. He did not yell at all. He talked with this perfect tone, and it always made me feel so much better. And every time that we were sick, he always was by my side to help. Every time he met someone, he always had the biggest smile on his face, because he had the biggest heart. So that's why he was such an amazing person, and I would like to thank my family and friends and teachers for always being there through these tough times. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming today. I would just like to say that I really appreciate just how much he impacted not only my family, but also my friends. Whether it's from school, whether it's maybe even in another state, they always have something about him to say that it lights up my heart just to see how many people are here today to support him. Everything he did, whether it was for family or friends, was always with a purpose. And it will never be forgotten, especially not from anyone in this room. Thank you all for coming.
Come on up. While they're coming up, I'm gonna read a poem that the boys were concerned about making people cry and didn't know if they could get through it. Ironically, I'm the one that's trying not to cry. Pray for my dad. Dear God, I gratefully thank you for giving me my dad. You must really love me because you gave the best you had. Watch over him and bless him and keep him in your care. And may he feel my love for him is my humble, heartfelt prayer. Do we have any family that wants to share? I hope you have it written down because it's all I can do.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. It's a beautiful day. I'm Kristen Clayton Radko. Robert is my little brother. So a few words to share about my not so little, amazing little brother. We had such a fantastic family get together this past Thanksgiving holiday, celebrating our parents. Eating, drinking, playing games, off-roading, shooting, and enjoying each other along with all of our kids' significant others, and a new grandbaby. Not mine, Laura's, of course. It would be Laura's because Robert affectionately named her the OG Pez dispenser in regards to her four closely spaced offspring. As our Thanksgiving holiday came to a close, I will never forget that goodbye bear hug that he gave me. We were all so happy. In the short time following, you became ill with COVID, and ever since then, I find myself saying, life is not fair, which I didn't know. Other people shared that with me till the other day. Anyway, why would you be taken from us all? Then I remember the funny, truly one-of-a-kind little brother of mine. The brother who fought a boy much bigger than he to protect his sister, Laura. The brother who rode his bike up the hill to his big sister's, me, boyfriend's house, that one right there, to say, you better get home because mom and dad are on their way and you're in trouble. Well, now life is not fair that you're gone and I still need advice from you. Life is not fair when I hug your wife and your children, but we cannot hug you. Sorry. I pray that with God's help, one day, instead of my mind jumping immediately to life's not fair, it will instead jump to how God blessed me and us all with your amazing presence. My little brother, he was unable to give a last farewell, unable to say goodbye, gone before we knew it, and only God knows why. If love alone could have saved you, you never would have died. In life, we loved you deeply, and in death, we love you still. Our hearts hold a place which for you, no one else can fill. As it has broke our hearts to lose you, you didn't go alone. For part of us went with you the day God called you home. and in searching for words to express what I've been feeling these past months, I came across a passage which kind of hit home for me, so I'm just going to read it. It's author unknown, but the title is God Saw You. God saw you getting tired when a cure was not to be. He wrapped his arms around you and whispered, "Come to me." You didn't deserve what you went through, so he gave you a rest. God's garden must be beautiful, for he only takes the best. And when I saw you sleeping so peaceful and free from pain, I could not wish you back to suffer that again. So, thank you.
Come on now.
Good afternoon. People might be wondering, like, something doesn't, like, look kind of the same, right, with me up here speaking, and that's one of the things I really love about Rob. My name is Artie Copeland. I've known Rob since we've been 3 years old. He's been my best friend since 3 years old. I love every person in the Clayton family. Since we've known each other, it's never been the Claytons or the Copelands. We've been one. All right, and so Kristen, Laura, Nicole, Drew, Garrett, I love you guys. I always love you with all my heart. As I was thinking about what I'd say today, what came across me is, how do I express Robert to others through my eyes? The way that I express Robert is family. I express Robert as grounded. I express him as loving. And I express him as fun. I got to see all of those all the time. As family, I looked up to him as, this is what it's like to be a husband. I looked up to him as a father, that this is how you interact with your kids. This is how you just be the best that you can be for your family. As brother, Kristen mentioned some of the things as well, but for me as a brother as well, he did the exact same thing. Right, there was a time where I was expressing to Drew where there was a special individual when we were probably in seventh grade that lived quite far away from us. And needless to say, we shouldn't have been riding our bikes to go visit that person while he had a broken hand. But in true Robert fashion, he's like, no, let's go do it. Like, you want to go it? Let's go. And so we proceeded to get on our bikes and ride across what seemed like at the time in seventh grade, half of Las Vegas to get there. And through there, by the time we got there, needless to say, we couldn't spend any time there. And so we had to get right back on our bikes and ride all the way back. And proceeding to ride back, we crossed the paths of my dad, who was driving home. Needless to say, that we both looked at each other and said, well, this is not going to be good. Because as I alluded before, is the Clayton and Copeland were family. So there was the rule of, if somebody got in trouble, both got in trouble. So we knew immediately my dad was calling Bob and Geraldine. And so we were both were in trouble. And, you know, as for being grounded, he was so prideful, right? Those that knew him, he was just beaming with pride. He wouldn't ask of anything from anybody, but yet would give everything of himself to everybody. right? And you don't find many people that are truly willing and want to do that with nothing in return. Dependable. I couldn't ask for anybody else that is more dependable, right? Although we lived far apart, we were always there together. We didn't speak every single day, but we knew all we had to do was make one text or one phone call, and the other would be there instantaneously doing anything for that other person and loving. He just loves, right? You always saw a smile on his face. You always saw him just wanting to just do something and be different. And from a fun perspective, outdoors, that was his love, that was his life, right? Being outdoors, whether it was fishing, hunting, camping, like that was it. And then sports. I think sports was his other love, right? And that's where we just continue to bond and bond, was through sports. So in closing, Robert, I miss you. I love you. And you will always be in my heart. And I love you too, Nicole. You guys will always be my heart, and I'm always here for you. Always, always, always here for you. Thank you.
Anybody else? Come on up, buddy.
Hello. I just wanted to say something. What happened to me a couple months after the incident? I was actually at baseball practice, and we were in something called a batting cage, which you guys have probably heard of. I was struggling since I've had haven't played it in a while, and I was struggling to hit the ball. And all I heard in my left ear was a whisper. It was a whisper from someone, and it wasn't anybody. It was just him. It was him saying, "You've got this, buddy." And then I hit the ball perfectly. So that just tells all of us in this room that he's still in our heart. Thank you.
I think we're going to take some time and reflect on Robert with a video that we've prepared, and we'll regather after that.
There goes my heart beating, 'cause you are the reason I'm losing my sleep. Please come back now. And there goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hopeless now. I'd climb every mountain and swim just to be with you and fix what I broke. Oh, 'cause I need you to see that you are the reason. There goes my head shaking, the reason my heart keeps bleeding, and I need you now. And if I could turn back the clock, I'd make sure the light defeated the dark. I'd spend every hour of every day keeping you safe. cause I need you to see that you are the reason. I don't wanna feel no more. I don't wanna hurt no more. I don't wanna cry no more. Come back, I need you. You are the reason. Just a little closer. Come a little closer. I need you to hold me tonight. I'd climb every mountain and swim every ocean just to be with you and fix what I've broken. Cause I need you to see that you are the reason.
Goes out. take my hand, hold it tight. I will protect you from all around you. I will be here, don't you cry. Falling so small, you seem so strong. My arms will hold you, keep you safe and warm. This bond between us can't be broken. Yes, you'll be in my heart from this day on, now and forevermore. You'll be in my heart, no matter what they say. What they can't explain. Well, I know we're different, but deep inside us, we're not that different at all.
I can hear those echoes in the wind at night, calling me back in time, back to you, in a place far away where the water meets the sky. The thought of it makes me smile. You are my tomorrow. I'll see you again. Oh, this is not where it ends. I will carry you with me. Oh, till I see you again. Sometimes I feel my heart is breaking, but I stay strong and I hold on, 'cause I know I'll see you again. Oh, this is not where it ends. I'll carry
explain the suburban picture in there of all things. Robert and I actually shared an affinity towards square body Chevy trucks. Those of you don't know, that's 73 through 87. And there was a Suburban that was sitting down by the roundabout. I was looking at it, and my wife, Suburban that she drives every day, was giving us fits. And so I was trying to talk her into buying this old square body Chevy Suburban with a manual transmission, the old farm transmission. And couldn't talk her into it, but lo and behold, who bought it? Robert. Nicole didn't have to drive it every day, but that was his baby. So we shared a lot of laughs about that. Another poem that Nicole wanted me to read: I am still here. Just because you cannot see me does not mean I am not here. Because I am in heaven does not mean I do not care. I often see you crying. You often call my name. I want to hold you tight. I want to ease your pain. It's easy for me, for I know heaven is real. If you knew the truth, how much better you would feel. One day we will meet again, but only when the time is right. When you step through the darkness, I will be in the light. It's really hard when we come together to find the positives in the death of a loved one. I'm going to share a story from the Bible, a story of love and tragedy, death, hope, and inspiration. Jesus was sent as the Son of Man to this earth by God his Father, to be born of a human mother. Jesus was raised in a family with siblings, worked alongside his earthly father as a carpenter, living in their village, pretty common-like. However, there was something obviously different about Jesus, and Jesus began to teach the elders and school the teachers about the Bible, even at a young age. And when it was his time, he began his ministry. He gained a following. He had disciples. Huge crowds by the thousands would come to hear him speak of the good news that he was bringing through Jesus. The religious rulers of the time were threatened by him. The truth he was speaking of the fulfillment of the Old Testament, they thought he was blaspheming. They manipulated the Roman government into viewing him as a threat. In the end, Jesus was tried in a human court and brutally put to death. But Jesus conquered death and rose from the grave, and in that very act gave us all hope. And it's a hope that changed the world forever. Jesus was only on earth for 33 years. His heavenly Father sent him to live and to love and to teach and to guide us, to put to death, to be put to death, and then to inspire us with hope when he conquered death. So not even God's own son was spared having to experience death. Yet the impact of Jesus lives on and gives us hope today. When Robert died, it was God and the hope in Christ that Nicole turned to help get her through this time. And I don't think I'm solving any great mystery when I say we all know that we'll die someday. So why was Robert's death so tragic? It was tragic for a number of reasons. Robert was way too young. He had a lovely wife that he shared a great love with, and without question, cared for her. Robert had two great children, two boys that Robert had started down the path of growing into fine young men. Robert was a caring son, brother, he was a great friend. These are the reasons it makes it hard. Robert's death brings up a lot more questions about why than answers. And I'm not going to pretend that I have the answers to these questions. I've been to many funerals growing up in the church in Prescott, same church, same community. I've seen a lot of people die. Great men and women who led amazing lives and touched a lot of people. My grandmother recently passed about 6 months ago. She was a pillar in our church, our community, our family, obviously. But she was 99. So we consider it a great life, and we're okay with that. My grandpa was a great God-serving guy. His memory still lives on, but he was only 55 when he died. I can't answer why. A dear mentor of mine was on a prayer vigil in England. Really not good when I look up. They were split up into teams, went out into the neighborhoods and prayed. Came back together, had a prayer session, he had a heart attack, and he died. And I can't tell you why. I've been to funerals for infants, for children who just barely started their lives. I've been to funerals for those who tragically took their own lives. I can't answer the question why God allowed these people to be taken from us, or how to make these deaths easier to accept. But I will tell you that over the years, I have appreciated and in many ways been inspired at funerals. The words spoken of these people and the thoughts that were inspired by the words and reflections meant a lot. In the Bible, God tells us that it is better to enter the house of mourning than the house of joy. Ecclesiastes 7:1-4, a good name is better than a good oil, and the day of one's death is better than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting, because that is the end of every person, and the living takes it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for when a face is sad, a heart will be happy. The mind of the wise is in the house of the mourning, while the mind of fools is in the house of pleasure. It's pretty sobering thoughts, really, and it's not a very joyous verse, but the point is, when we go to funerals, there's a lot of reflection that happens. It's a time where we take an accounting of other people, of other lives, of ourselves. And I found this truth at a young age. For me, it was probably because my grandfather passed before I was born, even though his memory lived on. My father was not a huge part of my life on a daily basis as a young child. So when I went to funerals for men in the church or people I knew, it was time where I could get some insight as to how these men were. What motivated them? What they vested their time in? How they treated others, their relationships with God, and what attributes people valued in them. Funerals were in many ways inspirational. I found they motivated me as to the type of man I wanted to grow up to be, a loving husband, caring father. I wanted people to know I cared for them. I wanted people to respect me. I wanted people to be inspired by me, and I wanted people to see Christ in me. In attending these funerals and pondering life, I found that one thing remained constant: God. God is who we look to for peace in this situation and to give us hope and inspiration. I reflect on the memories of Robert and Nicole that the boys discussed when we were preparing for Robert's funeral. Robert was a loving and caring husband to Nicole. Robert not only said that, but he lived it. He cared for her and demonstrated it. When he decided to take a job in Prescott, he didn't really discuss it with her. He took the job as a surprise and a gift to her because he knew she wanted to move to Prescott. Vegas was his home turf where he grew up. He didn't personally have a great desire to leave, but he knew that it meant a lot to Nicole, and so he gladly took the job. Or when he came to the clinic at 5:30 in the morning, unfortunately that's when I'm always there every morning, but he came to the clinic and decorated her office space so that she would be surprised on her birthday when she came in. Or when he worked long hours for her family and supporting them, making sacrifices, although I don't think he would ever consider them sacrifices. Robert was a loving, caring father for Drew and Garrett. He lived his love for them. Robert supported them in their sports, trucked them all over the state doing games and activities. He took them camping, exploring, off-roading, fishing, the stuff boys do, but he did it with them and loved them. But he also spoke into their lives by being a living example of how to love and treat their mom, how to provide for a family. He modeled how to treat other people. He shared little pearls of wisdom on a daily basis with Drew and Garrett. That wisdom, those pearls, will impact their lives forever. That wisdom and pearls will impact them as they grow into young men, seek further education, careers, wives, families. Sure, it'd have been nice if Robert and Nicole could grow old on the porch and watch the grandkids grow and all that kind of stuff. But that's not the reality. The reality is Robert was physically taken from us far too early. But the truth is that though his life was short, he has left a lasting impression, an inspirational impression on our hearts and our minds. Robert lived a godly life and gave us inspiration to do the same. Nicole, I encourage you in the times to come not to focus on the fact that Robert is no longer physically with you, but to focus on the inspiration that came through the love that you and he share. That love can inspire you for the rest of your life. Drew and Garrett, I challenge you to reflect on what your dad has taught you already about how you should act, how you should love others, how you should someday love your own wives and families. You were both able to quickly and easily recall quotes and sayings of your dad, funny stories of your dad, inspirational thoughts from your dad. Hold on to those thoughts and let them give you inspiration as you live your life. Friends and family, I challenge you to go into your worlds and be inspired by the life that Robert lived. Carry him with you in how you love and care for your family, how you treat people, and how you do business with people. Don't let Robert's legacy stop today. Allow the time you had with him to inspire you. Allow the God that we saw in Robert be your inspiration.
So I'll hold you as close as as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
This time I'm going to have the family exit out to this door right here on your left. While they're getting out there, just remind you that they're going to be out there for a period of time to greet you and to take your condolences and meet with you for a moment. We'll allow them a second to get out. So again, I want to thank you all for coming on behalf of the Claytons and Nicole and the boys. Thank you for sharing that time. Thank you for bearing with me. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that we had together in your name, sharing thoughts and memories and the love of Robert. Thank you for blessing us with Robert. Even though it was a brief time, we thank you for that. Thank you for the lessons we've learned through our lives with Robert and our interactions with Robert. And God, I just ask that you be with us as we mourn, but be with us as we give thanks and have joy for Robert. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.